Are you struggling with fear, depression, or anxiety? Are you in search of meaning and purpose? Would you like help navigating your current life circumstances? Tarot can help. Tarot is a powerful tool for healing, introspection, and spiritual awakening. The Esoteric Toolkit is a synthesis of ancient wisdom and modern science. It consists of tarot, numerology, astrology, and the Hermetic principles in conjunction with the modern science of consciousness. The revelation and application of this knowledge gives you the tools you need to help master your life, organize your mind, and overcome depression, fear, and anxiety. Learn to manifest your dreams and come into alignment with your highest self and the universe. Book your private one-on-one tarot reading today. Click the link in the description or go to www.theorderofchaosmagic.com. You can also find monthly tarot packages, a private Discord community featuring shadow work, and Mercury retrograde support groups, and much more by becoming a patron at patreon.com/theorderofchaos.
All right, welcome back to the Order of Chaos podcast. Today I have with me Hagen von Tullian, returning for a second time to the show, and we're going to be discussing his new seminar, Stellar Gnosis, the Necronomicon, Alien Gods, and Chaos Magic. And I'm so excited for this episode, so all that is coming up today on the Order of Chaos podcast. Man, how are you?
Oh, fine, thank you. It's great to be here again. We had also a very great and inspiring and lovely interview before here on your very nice podcast, and so I'm really happy and I will be here again with you. Yeah, that we could discuss my new seminar. I think we will have a good chat here tonight.
Yeah, I agree. This is a fascinating topic. It's one that I've really kind of looked into. I've used it. I've gone back and forth about how I feel about it. And I think a lot of occultists feel this way about the topic of the Necronomicon. And so I'm really excited to hear your perspective on all this. I after our last conversation, I've always told people I think of you as like a chaos magic purist. And I think that that is so cool. And I love hearing your perspective on things. So right off the gate, what inspired you to create this new seminar?
Yeah. We want to reach for the stars. I think that's it. We want to reach for the stars. Just imagine, I think you and maybe all of our listeners now had the experience some time in their life, just lying there on the ground in a dark night with a very clear sky, without any clouds, without the moon, and you were lying there on your back and looking up into the sky and see all the stars, the Milky Way, and you had this feeling of awe because of you realize the immense vastness of the surrounding universe. Yeah, and it's a special kind of feeling, and even this feeling is kind of magical. And so as a magician, we want to use this stuff. And so basically, magic starts with very elementary stuff, the elements. Yeah, basic. The elements are very basic in magic. Yeah? We have earth, we have air, we have water, we have fire. These are all the components which are the main parts, the main components of our planet Earth. Yeah, we have the Earth, we have the rocks, we have all the flora and everything. Yeah, which surrounds us. We have immensely amounts of water on our planet. We are surrounded by air. We need air, and there's fire, the heat from the sun, the heat from the center of our planet, and so this is very basic, and it's also very magical. Many people speculate that this was one of the first, these were the first categories of magic, because you could attribute so much to it. You could attribute the the elements as I described them. You can attribute the four directions, north, south, east, and west. You could also attribute personal things of humans, for example, the bodies, the emotions, the thoughts, and the passions, and the will, and stuff like this. And a lot of people are speculating that the elements may have been the first coordinates, the first structures for humankind to practice their magic. And then later on, it could be that the gods were appearing. Maybe people were attributing godlike attributes to the elements, or to phenomena in their natural surroundings. For example, there were gods of thunder and lightning, for example, or fire gods, but not only gods, but spirits, everything. But later on, the gods became very specific, not only for natural phenomena, but also they represent a lot of human qualities, human forces. For example, they were specialists in the area. When you have, for example, a goddess or a god of love, it's a very human quality, and this god form, it could be female or it could be male, represents everything which you could connect with this idea of love, for example. Yeah? And so in comparison to the elements, which are very nature-oriented, and the gods later became more human centered. Maybe you could say it's a kind of the first psychological paradigm somehow. Every good pantheon in every mythology represents a very comprehensive psychology. You have entities for love, as I said before. You have entities for war, for hate, for vitality, entities for wisdom, for communication, and so on. And of course, for the real basic stuff in human life, for sex and for death. Yeah, and you always have entities which are specialists of human qualities. So we have the elements, the orientation in nature, we have the psychological makeup of humans, and this is mostly what is around here. But magic always likes to push the frontier really apart and likes to look forward. So what will, if we have the nature of our planet, if we have the nature of our planet Earth, if we have the planets of our solar system, what would be the next step? Yeah, it would be the before mentioned immense vastness of the universe, which surrounds us, and we are part. We are a small part of the universe. Meanwhile, we know that the Earth is not the center of the universe, that humankind is not the center of the universe, and so there is so much there which is surrounding us. And yeah, and so with stellar gnosis, with stellar magic, we want to reach for the stars. We want to see what kind of knowledge, what kind of wisdom, what kind of power could we find there in this universe, and how could we access it? And that's the main thing in stellar gnosis, and which I want to present in my upcoming seminar. And we want to reach for these areas, for these realms. We need some models how to orientate ourselves. And one of these models, for example, is the Necronomicon mythos, which was created mainly or firstly by H.P. Lovecraft. And this is could be quite an interesting model to navigate these dimensions, these areas.
Yeah, absolutely. And to touch on what you said in the beginning, I think every person out there who practices magic of any kind can really relate to what you were saying about just looking up at the night sky and wondering. I think that wonder is the core of what magic really is.
Yeah,
what I find to be really interesting as you were saying, you know, as mankind evolves, we were looking to the elements in the beginning and attributing them with as magical phenomenon, and we still do, and rightly so, they are. But as we move further and further away from our immediate surroundings in our awareness, as we look deeper into ideas like outer space, what we're doing at the same time is looking deeper inward to our, into ourselves and into this, the human psyche, as you were saying, and into archetypes of consciousness and the archetypes even of the subconscious, which is a fascinating topic, because it's almost as untouchable as the outer reaches of space. And yet we know it's there and we can look at it by going inward. And that brings me to one of the great occult secrets, as above, so below, as within, so without. And as we look out into space, simultaneously, we're looking inward further and further into the human psyche. And I mean, that's really the essence of what magic is understanding the correlation between your inner world and your outer world and looking deeper and deeper into both. So that's cool. That's phenomenal. And I think that, like, as you were saying, the Necronomicon could be a really interesting way to explore that topic.
Yeah, excellent. Excellent. Yeah, that you are bringing up this old axiom of as above, so below, as within, so without. And I also will touch upon these points in my seminar. Yeah, exactly like you described it. Yeah, because you can't differentiate it. Yeah? You always, if you're looking outside, you also look deep within. Yeah.
And you're looking deeper as we evolve. We're looking deeper and deeper in both directions. And it's truly fascinating. So my next question, and this is a hot topic among occultists everywhere. I hear arguments about this all the time. Do you personally feel that when H.P. Lovecraft was creating the concept of the Necronomicon and when he was writing his works, do you feel that he was in a way channeling or receiving a form of stellar gnosis himself? Or are these pure works of fiction that happen to correspond so well with what we as magicians do and believe?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, this is really a hot topic. It's an excellent question. Yeah, that we really have to address this point. Yeah, because it's, as you said, it's coming up all the time. Yeah, this discussion. But mainly because it's coming up, it's mainly it's basically the old question. Yeah, it's the old question: are these entities, are these gods, are these spirits, are they real? Are they existing there, independent of us, or are they only existing, for example, in our psyche, in our subconsciousness or something like this? Is it something that was there before humankind was created, or were the gods created by humankind? Yeah. Mm-hmm. So this is the old question of the hen and the egg, which came before, or is there really, or in this case, even better, is there really a difference? Yeah. And at the moment, we cannot give a definite and ultimate answer to this question, I would say. And a lot of great magicians traditions and systems that approached magic, at the end, they came up with, we don't care. I don't care.
Yeah.
If it's your choice of belief. Yeah, if you believe that it's exists independent of you, if it exists in a dimension independent, in another dimension or another realm independent of you, then it's your belief, and then it will work exactly how you want to have it. And on the other way around, it works exactly the same thing. Yeah? And some systems really are switching through these both opinions or these options. And so yeah, personally, in my experience, also when I was a beginner, I wanted to have some facts, some absolutes, or so, and to orient myself in this amount of interesting stuff which I was exploring. And when I came to magic, so it always, as a beginner, you want to have some fixed point where you can orientate yourself. And when you will be confronted with this question, yeah, is it for real? Is it for is it fiction, or is it it's human made? This is one of the first questions. But as I said, if it works, it doesn't. I don't care. And maybe it's not really a difference. Yeah, as we just said before, as above, so below; as within, so without. Maybe both of these approaches are real. Maybe there is a combination which really fits. Yeah, at the end, we don't know. We don't know if gods or spirits or these kind of entities exist, because nobody have ever met one of these entities, like in the flesh, like we are meeting other humans in the flesh, yeah. And we also don't know if the gods existed before us, if they have created us in their image, or if it was the other way around. It could also be that, like I said before, when people in former times on Earth, they were attributing qualities of personality to some nature phenomena, like the god of thunder. They created or invented maybe the god of thunder because they in this way they were able to address this kind of energy, this kind of god form even better when they are saying, oh, this is a god of thunder and he has this and this name and he has this and this attributes. And so it was this power, this force, this phenomenon was much more easier to address for these people if they were personifying this phenomenon. And this is a thing which is going on all the time on Earth, because humans are used to communicate with each other. This is the only thing how we survived in the former days, as a kind of tribe, as together with others. As hermits, yeah, and we would have not been able to fight as hermits with the tigers and with all these dangerous animals, or with some fighting tribes or clans or something like this. Only as a community, as together as a tribe, as a family, as a clan, and everything, we were able to survive. And so we were used to communicate, to address other people, and so it's quite natural for us to address also phenomena that we receive as spirits or as entities or as gods. And coming back to the beginning of your question, yeah, and what is the case with H.P. Lovecraft? Because a lot of people say, yeah, this is not real magic because Lovecraft invented it, or maybe he gets some dreams, some nightmares. So it's not really. A real system. It's only a pulp fiction story, and so, and you can't work magic. But as I wanted to show with my explanations before, we don't know how all the other stuff started. Maybe the gods were also some stories that some people invented in former some thousands of decades ago, some 100,000 years when we were sitting at the fire. They were inventing stories, yeah, to. And out of this, the gods evolved. Maybe it was the same process like which H.P. Lovecraft did, yeah, in some form. We don't know exactly. But what we know for sure is that the ideas of Lovecraft, the Necronomicon mythos, and all these ideas, they are very, very popular till this day, and they don't stop to fascinate a lot of people in some pulp way, in some tribal ways, also in a lot of esoteric ways. Even if when Lovecraft said, yeah, he's an atheist and he don't believe in all this stuff, yeah. But you could say a lot of people speculated that he may have tapped into something that was beyond his belief systems, or so that he made access to. This could be. But somehow we don't know. I don't know if we will ever know this exactly. But what we know is that there is something which was coming from his ideas or from his writings at the end, which really fascinates us and a lot of people. I will also demonstrate in my seminar how a lot of magicians were really fascinated by these ideas from Lovecraft, with the Necronomicon with us. And because a lot of magicians also have thought about, yeah, what is there outside? What is there something extraterrestrial, something greater human or so? Yeah. For example, Aleister Crowley, he said that maybe Ivers, who dictated the Book of Law, was an extraterrestrial. And we know that Kenneth Grant was really interested in these extraterrestrial endeavors. The whole purpose of the new ISIS Lodge was to make contact with these kind of areas, yeah, with this extraterrestrial stuff. Also, Kenneth Grant was also very interested in the Necronomicon ideas and in the Necronomicon mythos. Michael Burtjo also, yeah, he also was or still is very much involved. And yeah, I will give quite a short overview of all these
these occultists or these esotists in, of modern times who maybe not a comprehensive overview, but of some very striking persons.
Excellent. Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more. In my opinion, and this is why I love chaos magic, it truly doesn't matter. What matters is are you able to mold your belief system to fit with this system, and does it work for you? I think that a lot of people who are starting out on some sort of spiritual path or witchcraft practice are looking for objective truth. And they really want that. They need that to latch on to and say, okay, this practice is true and accurate, and I can move forward with it. And I started out that way, certainly. My introduction to occultism was through the Satanic Bible by Anton LaVey. And I thought to myself, well, this is what's true and what works, because it works for me. But then I tried other systems and they worked too. And if they worked too, then you start to realize that these different systems are more akin to different languages, and all languages work. They're all methods of communicating with the universe.
Exactly. These are kind of preferred wrappings. I have the image of wrapping. Somebody likes the ideas wrapped in this kind of stuff, and another person likes this kind of wrapping. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's presented. Yeah. But also the image of the different kind of communication system is also very appropriate. Yeah. Mm-hmm. For one person, it's better to communicate with these areas, with these realms, with these dimensions, with this symbolism, and another prefers another symbolism. Definitely.
Mm-hmm. And I like to think of, now this isn't simply what I'm not going to say that I believe this is to be true, but I believe this is a simple way of explaining the idea of gods to people who are maybe an atheist. And I enjoy this. Jordan Peterson said that if anger isn't a god, I don't know what is. And I love that, because it's true. Anger is a psychic force that can overtake any human at any time and change their behavior and make them act in crazy ways. And it's something that we all share. All human beings have the capability of anger. And so when I think of anger, I think of the god Set, for example, or Mars. And these sort of archetypes of consciousness are pervasive through all mythologies and all cultures. And what I think is interesting about Lovecraft's work is that he went past the conscious archetypes and went deeper into like the things that may have pre-existed even those psychic forces. And maybe that's why the Lovecraftian gods have been so inspirational and powerful to occultists, because they recognize something in it that is primal and interesting and speaks to their own subconscious minds.
Yeah, definitely. The whole Necronomicon mythos has great potential to expand our magical imagination into other dimensions, other realms.
Yes. Definitely. Yeah, and the imagery of these interdimensional aliens is wonderful and beautiful and horrifying and just everything that I love aesthetically. And I think that really helps when you're doing any type of magic. If you can aesthetically, you know, like you were saying, like, I like this type of wrapping. I like this aesthetic for my magic. Well, the Lovecraftian aesthetic is awesome. It's truly awesome. And that can bring a sense of passion to your magic. And that is what will make your magic work better, is having that personal connected link to it. It's not about whether or not it's specifically true. It's like, does it speak to your soul? Does it get you excited?
Definitely. I could only agree with you.
Yeah. So here's my next hot button question. This here, I'm sure many people are familiar with this book. This is the Simon Necronomicon. Will your seminar touch on this book at all?
Yes, but it will not be the main point. Could you imagine why?
Well, I could think of a number of reasons. It could spark just nonstop arguments.
Yeah. Just sum it up. As we know, the seminar is titled Stellar Gnosis or Stellar Magic. And if you look closer to the Simon Necronomicon, we will find that basically this Necronomicon, it's more like the traditional grimoires.
Yes.
But wrapped in these Sumerian imaginary. Yeah?
Right.
Imagine symbolism. Yeah.
I think a lot of people get confused because they'll buy this book thinking that they're getting a book of Lovecraftian magic, when in fact it is a book of Sumerian magic.
Exactly. That's a, when you look closer, you can see, you can find planetary magic. We mentioned before the planets as symbols for psychological qualities, for example, because when you look at the seals and the gates, you have these seven classical planets, like from Moon to Venus and up to Saturn, but wrapped in the symbology of the Sumerian. Yeah, so you find Marduk and Ishtar and all these names for these planets. So it's basically it's not going beyond our planetary system. It's just planetary magic. And then you look further, you could find these 50 names, these demons, like in the classical grimoires. You have sigils or seals, you have names, you have short descriptions about these areas in which they are working, which how you can use them. And also the author elaborated in his further books. Yeah, one of the follow-up books was called the Necronomicon Spellbook, and it also only was dealing with these 50 demons or 50 entities. And later on, the Book of the Gates or something like this, the Gates of the Necronomicon, and the Gates of the Necronomicon. It only deals mainly with these seven gates, with these seven traditional planets under the name of the Sumerian. So, as you said, yeah, if you're looking for some really Lovecraftian ideas, this Lovecraftian cosmicism of these outer gods, of these gods from the vastness of the universe, yeah, like Cthulhu, like Shub-Niggurath, and all this other stuff, up to Azathoth, you didn't find very much in the Simon Necronomicon about these entities. No? Sometimes you find a name which is really a little bit similar, like Cthulhu, written with a K, or Azathoth. Yeah, it's also quite similar to this, but in the end, it will not open up these stellar dimensions, yeah, if you are working with the Simon Necronomicon. So I will touch on this in the seminar, but it will not be the main focus of the seminar.
Very cool. I'm glad that you're taking it past the our solar system and into the true stellar gnosis area and into the Lovecraftian gods, because, you know, in my way of thinking, when you look at planetary magic or a book like the Necronomicon, any magical system dealing with ascension through the chakras or through the planets and that type of system, as the Ladder of Lights presents in the Necronomicon, you're dealing with exactly, like you said, our solar system and nothing beyond that. And that, to me, is akin to the conscious mind. Whereas the Lovecraftian gods are the outer realms, and now we're getting into the subconscious mind and the archetypes of our shadow, of our, you know, what we maybe call our moon sign, you know, the hidden deep dark stuff. And I think that's more fascinating to people. I do enjoy this book very much, and I do, in fact, I've had experience with some of the entities presented in the Necronomicon, so I'm not trying to knock it, but I do think a lot of people purchase it expecting more of a Lovecraftian vibe from the book than they actually get. What they actually get is a lesson on ancient Sumeria, which is fascinating. Yeah, yeah. But
exactly. I see it in the same way. Yeah, it's totally valid in itself, the Simon Necronomicon. Yeah, it's like all like some other grimoires. Yeah, it is a comprehensive system, and it's closed into the symbolism, and it could be very effective. You get a lot of things to do. You can work with all the spirits, with all the planets, and you could ascend the ladder through the gates, and it's really, really valid. Yeah, but yeah, as we said before, yeah, it doesn't go beyond our solar system. Yeah, it doesn't go into these other realms that we just mentioned before. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah, and I think that the author, who maybe it's Peter Lavenda, maybe it's not, he denies having written it.
Yeah, we all know.
we don't know. The story presented is fascinating, though, and I think it's interesting and it provides a good amount of. You know, Anton LaVey said that psychodrama is crucial to magic, and the book does provide a good amount of psychodrama. But I do feel like he made a bit of a leap at times trying to connect the Lovecraftian mythos to the Sumerian mythos. That there, I could never fully make the connections that he made, having studied both. I didn't come to the same conclusions, but. I do think he was trying to appeal to that need some people have to say, okay, this is real, you know, and that's valid. I think that's how a lot of people get introduced to the craft. Or any type of witchcraft at all. So that brings me to my next question, though. Now, throughout history, and I don't know if it began with Lovecraft or not, but there have been several books throughout time that have claimed to be the real Necronomicon. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, the real Necronomicon. All the books, all which claim to be the Necronomicon, and I have about, I think I would say about 10 there in my shelf behind me, 10 Necronomicons, 10 different editions or issues, and also some other files which you could easily download on the internet. Yeah, and I would say, as a quick answer, I would say, no, there's no real Necronomicon out there in the case that we imagine the Necronomicon to be. Because, a lot of people also said, I think it was Kenneth Grant, maybe he came up at first with the idea, but I'm not sure, that the real Necronomicon doesn't exist in our dimension. It exists as a kind of astral book or as a book in another dimension. And people who are approaching it, they only get glimpses out of it. And maybe all these manifested Necronomicons are just some parts of the greater Necronomicon, which exists there in some other dimension. And so maybe all of these Necronomicons are real in some case, but they are not complete. Maybe they are showing some glimpses from the Necronomicon. They were inspired by the idea of the Necronomicon. And the authors, because when an author sits down and writes a book which he entitled Necronomicon, he must be inspired by this idea. And he must approaching this idea of this Necronomicon. And he, in his way or her way, the author wants to present what's coming up in his mind or in his conscious or subconsciousness when he's dealing with the idea of the Necronomicon. So maybe all these editions that are going around are in some way, they are real, but they are not the complete Necronomicon. So maybe the real Necronomicon is very huge and will not be able to manifest in traditional book form as we know it here on Earth. But I prefer the idea to look at the Necronomicon as a kind of inspirational source for all these ideas that we attribute to the Necronomicon mythos, to extraterrestrial life, to preterhuman life, and all these ideas which are related to this. And so this could be a kind of focus for all these ideas. And yeah, it would be... isn't it a nice idea that you could imagine that you are expanding your consciousness, your mind into some other dimension, some other realm, and there you could find a book that you can open and there you could find some ideas, some mysteries and some inspirations. Yeah, it's a great idea.
It is a great idea. In fact, what you were saying, I think that makes a lot of sense that the Necronomicon could in fact be sort of an astral realm book. Two other books that come to mind are the Book of Thoth, which no one knows if it really exists. And I'm not talking about the Book of Thoth written by Aleister Crowley. I'm talking about the idea of the Book of Ultimate Wisdom or even the Akashic Records. These are all sort of similar concepts. And what I think is cool, the Necronomicon could be another name for what some people in some traditional crafts call their own personal book of shadows. You could have your own Necronomicon, your book of personal gnosis. It could be your book of spells or your book of insights, because Necronomicon translates to Book of the Dead. And of course, to me or to any occultist, I think they would read that as the Book of the Other Side. And what do we get from the other side? Well, we get inspiration and gnosis, and it's personal to every person. It filters through them individually and differently. And that's certainly what could have been happening with H.P. Lovecraft.
Definitely, definitely, yeah. And maybe I also manifested a kind of my own Necronomicon, yeah, with my new because also it deals with some entities, yeah, from the Necronomicon readers in the end, yeah. So maybe this was my glimpse of the real Necronomicon.
Yeah, I really think that you're onto something. That the Necronomicon could be this vast repertoire of knowledge that could never fit into a physical book as we know it, but we each get glimpses of it and ideas from it, receive inspiration, receive gnosis from it. I love that. So when you were inspired to create this seminar, was it because, were you reading Lovecraft at the time? Have you always been a huge Lovecraft fan? Do you have a personal favorite story from Lovecraft?
Yeah. Oh, it's meanwhile, it's quite a long time ago since I first read a lot of Lovecraft stories. It was as a teenager, I said, yeah, it was very fascinated, and I have to reread even more to this day. And often I just look into some secondary material or in some stories. And when you're asking me for my favorite Lovecraft story, I would say it's a moment. I think it's Call of Cthulhu somehow. Yeah. Yeah?
And it's so good.
Yeah, and it also incorporates many of these elements. For example, there is something going on as which only certain people are able to receive. Yeah, for example, artists are creating weird art, weird paintings and statues of strange entities because they are receiving the vibes, the vibrations, or something. Yeah, from the outside. Yeah, and so yeah, especially this aspect really inspires me as an artist, yeah, because I'm also working in this kind of way. And also these cults that are mentioned there in the story are these weird and strange voodoo rites in near New Orleans in Louisiana, yeah, and, mm-hmm. and all over the world, strange cults and sects are receiving these vibrations and starting to doing their rituals. And yeah, these ideas are very, they summarize very good this approach, yeah, that if you are tuning in into these dimensions and using the symbolism of the Necronomicon mythos and to tune in into something beyond our solar system, something which makes you able to access this, the knowledge and the power in the vastness of this universe. Yeah, and all these ideas are really, really good transported in the story, yeah, and described in the story. Yeah,
yeah, they are. It's such a great story. And I, like you were saying, I think it summarizes and depicts the occult experience in such a wonderful way and in such a cool story that's compelling and it's frightening and it's thrilling. And it's got this, what I really love about it in terms of symbolism is that in the story, if anyone were to actually face Cthulhu, he would go mad instantly. And I think that that's a great metaphor for looking at our own psyche, for looking into our own subconscious mind. I just absolutely love that. And I do think that, you know, we as magicians can go mad in a sort of way. The deeper down these rabbit holes we go, you know, you have to keep yourself grounded or you can be looking right into the face of madness. And but we do it anyway. We do it anyway because we want to know. We want to know what's there. It encompasses the occult experience so well. I absolutely love it. So I've got to agree with you. That's my all-time favorite. I love the imagery of Cthulhu. And you know, so one of the reasons that I'm so excited about your seminar is that I've done this before, not working with the Simon Necronomicon, but even just using the imagery of Cthulhu to create a my own sort of thought-formed entity of which to bounce my magic off of. And I found that to be incredibly powerful, and especially for manifestation. I was able to manifest incredible things into my life using an entity that I knew to be at least somewhat fictional. And, you know, I wasn't thinking of Cthulhu as a real thing. What I was doing was intentionally creating a thought form based on a book that I enjoyed and bounced my magic off of it and got real results. And that was one of the initial experiences that drew me to chaos magic and said, this is the path for me, because I realize it's about the potential of your own mind and about understanding that the world is sort of built out of symbolism. And when you understand those symbols, you can use them with incredible power.
Yeah, I could only agree.
And I think Lovecraft knew that. I think he totally knew it. I don't know if he was a magician himself, but certainly he tapped into occult wisdom. I think that that's certain, that he was tapping into some sort of source of occult wisdom and knowledge and power, the same source that we tap into when we do magic. And to go even further, you know, the Cthulhu story describes the way in which real religions have manifested on planet Earth. I mean, a dozen over and over and over again, you'll find cultures that have tuned into the vibrations of a certain deity and received this gnosis and created rituals and built entire civilizations based on that particular deity. And to see that playing out throughout the story of Call of Cthulhu is it brings shivers to you because you realize this has really happened. This is a huge part of the human story.
Yeah, definitely.
So how do you feel that the Lovecraftian gods differ, if they do differ, from traditional mythologies, like, let's say, Norse mythology or Sumerian or Egyptian mythology?
I would say yes, they differ. I would say they differ mainly because most of the pantheons are dealing with the planetary gods.
Yeah.
For example, when you look at the well-known systems in the West, the Roman gods or the Greek gods, these are only human specialists, yeah, human qualities which they represent, and they represent these qualities to an really excessive amount. For example, if you are meeting a person who is only possessed by Mars, for example, yeah, who only expresses all the qualities of Mars, I think you would have a hard time to spend with this person very long times. Yeah, because if he's always in an aggression mood, always in anger, and always wants to fight and combat and everything, this is not how you could fill your life only with these ideas. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you also need the other gods also and goddesses. That's why a pantheon is always tries to include all the qualities that the human psyche expresses, yeah, and symbolizes. So most of these pantheons are dealing with the human side, and especially when we look at some of these occultists who were attracted to the Necronomicon mythos. Years ago, when I was younger, and I found out that some people are trying to relate the entities, the gods of the Necronomicon mythos with the planetary gods or with the Tree of Life of the Kabbalah, for example, attributing the entities to the Tree of Life, it never really satisfied me. I always said, no, these entities like Cthulhu and all the other entities, they are way beyond these systems. They don't fit with these psychological ideas of humankind. It's really something which goes beyond all this. Yeah, and so at the end, only these mythologies which are dealing with these areas beyond could be compared to the Necronomicon mythos. But as we know, a lot of mythologies. Yeah, they found out, okay, there is something greater in the universe. Maybe there is something which is everywhere in the cosmos, in the universe, which has created it, but mostly it's really not accessible. For example, in India, they called it Brahma, and then they left it alone because it was not really addressable. Yeah, as we said before, humans like to address these qualities, these forces. Yeah, but if you have such a vast force, a vast quality, which created the whole universe, you can't address it for your personal endeavors, yeah, because this force doesn't care what you want or what you want to have. And there you have to look for the specialists in the solar system or on this planet, yeah, to achieve your results, your intentions and everything. And like in the Indian system, for example, in the Voodoo system also, there's a creator god, but they also, it's way beyond, and they were dealing mostly with the lower because they are close to humankind. And this we could find in many systems, also in Asian systems, Asia, in the systems like, for example, in Taoism. Yeah, there's a great Tao, and it's there, but out of the Tao, all the thousand things evolve. Yeah, and this is where you can handle these things. Yeah, and so in many of mythologies, you have some greater force, but which is not really very suited to be addressed by humankind. But you have a great pantheon of gods and spirits and demons and other kind of entities which you could address. And with these entities, you can communicate and you can interact, yeah, much more easily. And in this way, these the entities of from Lovecraft, from the Necronomicon, they are beyond, but they are in somehow in some way they are much more addressable somehow. We will come to this later, I would say.
Yeah. And it's interesting you say that, because I think it's fascinating that as we on Earth, as our science progresses, we discover forces that go far beyond the traditional elements. We're looking at quantum forces. And we touched on this in the last interview, but I think this is brilliant, that maybe the Lovecraftian gods, and they represent the dissection of that great outer force like the Tao into the qualities of space and time and entropy, you know, forces that there were no words for in ancient times that we've only recently discovered. And it's fascinating that as we discovered them, there's also this new pantheon of outer gods that is so appealing to occultists all over the world, and that they sort of link up together.
Yep.
I think it's fascinating, and it's the next phase. As we learn more, we create new languages for phenomenon that we didn't know existed before. And so we have to create, in the discovery of these phenomenon, there have to be, like archetypes and psychic forces that go along with them in order to explain them. That's just kind of the nature of how things work.
Yeah, definitely.
So have you had yourself any personal experiences with these forces or entities of the Lovecraftian gods?
Yeah, definitely. When I was younger, I participated in rituals which were constructed by some friends of mine, but it was always not really satisfying to me. Yeah? It was more that they were creating a kind of weird and strange atmosphere. And after this ritual, this weird atmosphere lasted really long. And I was always wondering, is this the only thing that they wanted to achieve with this kind of working? There must be something more, just to create a very weird atmosphere, very, very weird state of mind. Is it all that we want to achieve with this ritual? So I was not really satisfied with these workings, or other rituals where people were creating sigils and imagining that their sigil is going down in the ocean, down into the sunken city of Tuurili, and there and really when it reaches really it get empowered. And so I said, no, you can't work with really and with Cthulhu just to empower your sigil to, I don't know what you want to get with this sigil. Yeah. And it's not the real way, but I was really fascinated with the idea. And several years ago on Arcanorium College, it was an online site which was created by Pete Carroll, the founder of Chaos Magic. They were really exploring the entities and in a chaos magical way. And out of this, all these the results from these experiments and from these researches were summarized in Pete Carroll's book, The Epoch, The Esotericon, The Portals of Chaos, where he also presents a kind of Necronomicon, a kind of chaos Necronomicon. And these ideas really resonated with me really, really a lot, because the entities were not related to the planetary gods, like I said before, to the Tree of Life or something, but they were really beyond the planetary system. And so I unfortunately was not a member of this Arcanorium College when they were creating all these ideas, but later I became a member and also a tutor of Arcanorium College. And then we did some long-term workings with these entities. And I participated in both of these working, and each working lasted 1 year long as a group. It was a group of international magicians which were coordinating through this website, and we were going from one entity to the next, and we used the main six main gods of the Necronomicon mythos, starting with Nyarlathotep, with Cthulhu, Shub-Niggurath, Hastur, Yog-Sothoth and Azathoth. And for each, it was nearly 1 or 2 months, about 2 months for each of these entities. So we ended up with a cycle of 1 year. Yeah, and in the first working, it was more that we were making contact with these entities, and we were asking our personal questions and wanted to receive knowledge that was relevant to each of the participants. And in the second run, we coordinated these questions even more, so that not everybody was in the Cthulhu months, everybody was asking his or her own questions, but we came together on the internet, and then we exchanged idea what we want to ask. And so we came out with a bunch of questions for each of these entities, and each of us was asking the same questions when each of us was doing our own ritual. And this was really quite intense period, both of these entities. And it, for me personally, it doesn't stopped after each of these years. Yeah, it's still continued in several ways afterwards and till today. And so in my seminar, this is basically the approach that I will present. I will give an overview of all these ideas that we have discussed up till now here in our interview now. And then I will look at these main gods from this chaos magical point of view. Because in what makes it so specific is that as I said before, humankind likes to personify some forces, some qualities, so it could be better addressed. And so these entities from the Necronomicon mythos are very much suited as addressable forms in the outer realms. So we looked at all these ideas that came along with these entities, how they were described in the stories and by Lovecraft and his followers later on. And so we find out that there are some special traits which really are very unique to each of these entity. And for example, when we start with Nyarlathotep, he's a kind of portal. He's a kind of emissary. He's a gate to the elder gods. I just called them the elder gods. I know that Lovecraft, he differentiated, and also in the mythos, you have the old ones, you have the great old ones, you have the elder gods, and you have the deep ones and everything. We just call them the elder gods. Yeah, it's not that we wanted to be very authentic and differentiate each of them, but these are only the elder gods. Or you could call them also the outer gods or the old one. It doesn't matter. So Nyarlathotep, it's a kind of portal to these other entities, because Nyarlathotep is it's mainly the only entity who appears in a semi-human form. He appears in thousands of different forms, but mostly they are somehow human. Yeah. In comparison, for example, to the depictions of Yog-Sothoth, who is just a mass of globules, of spheres, or something like this, yeah, and like a cosmic foam or something like this, yeah. And but Nyarlathotep, and also Nyarlathotep represents the will of the magician to reach out to the stars, to reach out for all this knowledge, to reach out for the powers which could be found there, because if you want to know something about life and the universe and everything, it must be found somewhere in the universe itself. Yeah, and so these entities could be very helpful for us to find out even more. Yeah, as I said before, they are not like Brahma or the Tao or something which is really inaccessible. Yeah, but these are like ways which could be helpful for us as magicians to reach out and to get something back that we want. So, for example, the other entities, Cthulhu. Cthulhu, we attributed to Cthulhu everything which has to do with sentience. For example, everything has to do with brain or with mind or with consciousness. And even if you look at the image, yeah, it's a kind of octopus. Yeah, you have kind of brain with tentacles. It could be kind of like the neural connections to everything. Yeah, and even if you look at pictures, for example, of the neural network in the human brain, and you compare it with this, with the models that scientists created out of the universe itself, yeah, it looks really similar. Yeah, it's always connected with like neural connections or something. And and also when you look at the idea that Cthulhu lies there in his city of really, he lies there dreaming. Yeah, and dreaming is it's an activity of the mind. It's not a body activity. Yeah, and as we said before in the story Call of Cthulhu, yeah, people who are sensible or open to this, they could reach out and they could feel these dreams, yeah, and they could connect to the dreams of Cthulhu. These are all mental stuff. These are all things that have to do with the mind and with these kind of areas. And in comparison, for example, Shub-Niggurath was called the goat with a thousand young. Yeah? This is a very bodily thing, yeah, and so you could attribute everything which has to do with biology to Shub-Niggurath. Everything which has to do with the creation and destruction of life could be attributed to Shub-Niggurath. So as we could see now, these entities could be attributed to really to the ultra structures of reality. We have sentience, consciousness with Cthulhu. We have biology, evolution, and all these similar things attributed to Shub-Niggurath. And then we have, for example, Hastur. It's a futility of everything. Everything must be going down at some point, yeah, even in a cosmic scale, yeah. So you have somehow you have mind, you have body, and you have the futility of everything, yeah. And but on a cosmic scale, yeah. And even going beyond that, Yog-Sothoth could be attributed with time and space. And Azathoth with matter and energy and with the core of chaos itself, because he is described as a blind idiot god at the center of chaos, yeah. And so he is creation itself, yeah. And Yog-Sothoth, just imagine the concepts of space and time. If you could get information about this, yeah, you could get information maybe about time travel, about space travel, other dimensions. And because when we want to reach for the stars, yeah, it's not so, we could not, maybe as a magician, I would say it's not the way that we are building some transport thing out of metal and shoot it out into the stars. And even with a kind of, maybe it's another kind of space travel that we have to look out. Yeah. And maybe Yog-Sothoth could help us with this. Yeah. It's more a kind of traveling outside in, yeah, with a mind somehow, with some in some other, because as we said before, yeah, as above, so below, as within, so without. If we could travel within, deep within, in the same way we could travel really without and could explore the universe. We know this that people already are doing this. We have science fiction, and people are imagining all this. What could be going on there in space? And people are already doing. And we know that especially science fiction at one point it really comes into life. Yeah, when we look at former science fiction, Jules Verne, at the ideas of submarines. Yeah, when they still not existed, of traveling to the moon. Yeah, we know that everything existed. Meanwhile, yeah, we have submarines. We travel to the moon and everything. And maybe all the better science fiction that is currently around will be also sometimes manifest somehow. Yeah, and when you want to travel space, do you really want to do this in your body? You don't know what to expect there. Yeah? Some radiations, gravity, some other stuff where the human body is not really fitted. Yeah, to survive somehow. It's much better maybe to travel in the mind into a vehicle which is much more suited. Well, for example, if you could travel with your mind to another planet and with your mind go into one of the inhabitants of this planet, because this inhabitant is really suited for this other kind of planet, yeah. And there you could look through the eyes of of this inhabitant of this planet and explore all this other stuff. Maybe on the other way around, it already happens that the extraterrestrials are already looking to our eyes or to some of our eyes and exploring humankind in this way.
I think so. I was just about to say, I mean, that could be a large part of where our concepts of these gods come from, is that they could be looking right through our eyes, that they've discovered this technology of you know, because if we're going to travel to the edges of the universe, the physical bodies just can't do it unless we find some way to turn matter into something other than matter and transport it. But consciousness has no limits. Consciousness could travel to the edges of the universe and back in an instant. And I think that that's a far out concept, but it's a concept that's pervasive in occult circles and has been for decades for a good reason. Even the concept of astral travel, it's the same thing. It's, you know, physically we can't do these things, but non-physically we totally can. And it's just a matter of discovering the mechanism by which we do it. And I totally agree with you that by tapping into these outer forces, that's going to be where we receive the inspiration or the gnosis that informs us how to do this.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. As you said, yeah, the human body is not made for traveling so much distance. Yeah, consciousness is able, or information. We also know that information is not limited. Yeah, it could be here, it could be immediately on another place, and so. It would not make much sense to just send a spaceship, out there that it reaches somehow some other place. It's much more interesting to send out some other material stuff out there. It's much more, it would be much more better to just send out the information, because the information how to build such a device or something else, this could be really travel immediately through space and time. Yeah. And so maybe, yeah, and my ideas, and not only my, but to use these Necronomicon entities to get more information about all these matters that we just talked about, to get more information about the core processes of consciousness of the mind, to get more information about biology and evolution. Shub-Niggurath could be a very helpful entity, for example, for our current state of the planet. Yeah, we know that we are heading towards an ecological disaster if we continue this way. And maybe Shub-Niggurath could help to change the consciousness in this area for humankind. Yeah, that to live together with the biota in a very benign very benign ways, yeah. And so it's not only that these entities are just used for horrific purposes or so, yeah. They could really, these qualities that they could represent could in the end really helpful as a next step in human evolution somehow, because maybe these are the qualities we magicians and scientists always looked for. Yeah, so everybody, all the time, magicians and other people wanted to know the secrets of consciousness, the secret of life, and everything. The alchemists, they wanted to discover the secrets of life. Yeah, and when working in this kind of paradigm with these ideas, yeah, this could be very helpful. This is a kind of map. This is a kind of navigation map into these realms. And of course, these ideas of Lovecraft, that's with his horrific images and everything, when we are approaching such elemental forces about life itself, for example, this could be really horrific. Yeah. Just we know that humankind is able to make a big mess out of everything. Yeah, we know when people were able to split atoms, what they made out of that, atom bombs and other stuff, which is not really, really, really benign in the end. Yeah, to many other people. And when people came across the basic idea how to manipulate consciousness and mind and brain, how to manipulate these areas. Of course, this could be very horrifying, yeah, when people are using this in these in ways which, yeah, because it's such such a huge amount of knowledge which could be opened there. And if it, and as we know, if these very powerful qualities and this powerful knowledge and is coming into the wrong hands or is handled in the wrong way, this could be in the end very horrific for the people who are using it and for others. Humans always have the tendency to use this stuff for, I don't know, for purposes of war, for example, for dominate other people, and nowadays to further consumption of sheep products and stuff like this, and that some people got more wealthier than others because people have to buy and consume it. And so, of course, this could be a very horrific perspective, if humankind is not able to deal with such great concepts, that the Lovecraftian gods could represent. But as the magicians, we are always on the forefront and we always want to reach to new dimensions and to new realms. And so I think as magicians, we like to explore these ideas. Yeah. And when we look at history, we always where the magicians, where anything was coming from. Yeah. For example, all the sciences developed out of the esoteric arts. And we know chemistry, as we know today, developed out of alchemy, for example. Yeah, astronomy developed also out of astrology and all this stuff. Yeah, it comes all from the esoterists, all these great ideas. Yeah, and so maybe some of these ideas that former magicians created and they resulted in these disastrous situations that we have now at the moment. How humankind used these ideas in a disastrous form. And so nevertheless, as magicians, we have to look forward, we have to go beyond, and even with the risk that it could be horrifying, but it's also our duty to make the best out of it and to find ways that it will not be horrifying, but it will be some way helpful for the next step in evolution of humankind.
Yeah, I could not agree more. I think that we've entered into, and I mean, I think this is obvious to anybody who takes a look at the world. We've entered into a new paranormal paradigm, a renaissance of magic. And it is going to be magicians, the modern magicians and mystics working with scientists who lead the way into the future. Because it's going to take the close observation of consciousness to get a grip on what we can do scientifically. And to rein it in and to say what's right and what's wrong and stop doing things just because we can and start looking at the deeper meanings behind what we're doing, and that it's up to us. It's up to the mystics and the magicians to receive that stellar gnosis and, have input in the future and to be leaders of thought. I just really see that's coming. I think that there's a mass spiritual awakening happening in the world today. And now that we have the scientific tools to understand it on a more scientific level, and it isn't as religious as it once was, it's more free-form spirituality, that's going to become very popular and change the consciousness of the world. And I definitely think that this is, we're in a phase of rapid evolution. It's happening right now, and mysticism and magic are a huge part of that, and that's why I'm so excited to be attending your seminar. Again, I'm so excited about this. I know a little bit about working with Cthulhu as I've done it, but I have not done any work with any of the other outer gods. I'm super excited to hear what you have to say about that in the seminar and to really do this work. So for anyone out there who's listening right now and who wants to attend the seminar, how do they get tickets? When is it? And all that good stuff.
You can get all this information on a Facebook page. Look for Stellar Gnosis on Facebook. There is an event page for the seminar. It's on the weekend. I think it's the 10th and the 11th of September. I have to look up if it's really the correct date, but it's the weekend and around this time. But it's all, you could find it very easily on this event page. Just type into Stellar Gnosis or go to my Facebook or my Instagram page or my Twitter page. There are also links to the seminar, and it's organized by my Italian friends, and there you have to write to them, and for the tickets there are also some options there, because I did for them a Chaos Magic workshop seminar last year, nearly 1 year ago, and you could also get the recordings there. You could also get bundles, for example, yeah, to get the recording of last year's seminar, and together with tickets for the new seminar, and there are several options. Just look for on my pages, and maybe you could also put a link here under the in your podcast.
To the
event page, or to the where you could find more information.
Yeah, I definitely will include all the links. So for those of you listening on Spotify, they'll be in the episode description. Same thing on YouTube. I'll gather all those links and make them accessible to everybody. And I attended last year's seminar, and it blew my mind. It was so good. That's why I was so excited to have you on the show. It was fantastic. And I want to emphasize that it's better than average, because I've been to a lot of seminars. I've done a lot of magical seminars, and some of them have been excellent, but yours is definitely the most interactive and inspirational seminar that I've ever attended on magic. So I'm so excited for this next one.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, yeah, for this very, very nice and kind feedback. And yeah, I'm studying and I'm practicing magic now for about 4 decades, and nearly every day I'm into this stuff. Yeah, and it's that's really my passion. That's really my kind of thing. Yeah? Art and magic, and magic and art. And so I worked with a lot of different kind of peoples. I learned how to to coordinate people's in rituals spontaneously, and also with long preparations, and traditional magic and chaos magic. And I experienced a lot of stuff. And yeah, I found out that meanwhile I'm at the age where I could really share my experiences. Yeah, and that most of what I'm sharing, it's not just speculation or ideas that I read in other books, but it's coming from a long time of experience. And yeah, I always get this feedback that people are really get something out of it. Yeah, and because I also experienced it before. Yeah, I'm just sharing my experiences, not some ideas or some secondhand information, but mostly it's firsthand information, firsthand experience from my side.
Yeah, I definitely feel like that's what makes the difference, because a lot of times you'll attend a seminar and it's, you know, a workshop on the Hermetic principles, for example, which I've done and it was wonderful and helped me to understand them on a deeper level. But again, it's just reiterating and explaining ancient wisdom or, you know, esoteric knowledge that you could get in a book anywhere. But your seminars are, yeah, all about experience. And the seminar itself is an experience. I remember last year we did the creation of a servitor. That was fantastic. That's not something you experience in a normal seminar. So again, really excited for this one. You have a wonderful way of transferring the information and the energy from yourself to your audience. Okay, well, that's all we've got time for today. Thank you so much, Hagen. Again, I'm going to be at the seminar. So if you're out there listening, please come and join us. It's going to be great. Really looking forward to it. And thank you again for being on the show.
Yeah, thank you for inviting me. It was a pleasure.
Yeah, thanks so much, man. I'll see you again, and looking forward to the seminar, and I'll see you then.
All right, great, excellent.
Okay, bye-bye.